Sir Gerald Howarth.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, may I first put on record my appreciation to the Campaign for Marriage, who I think have done a fantastic job in informing not only members of this House but also the wider public about this issue. I oppose this legislation for five key reasons. The first, I believe it is simply wrong in principle. To overturn centuries of established custom requires a proper explanation beyond mouthing the equality mantra. What shaft of wisdom has suddenly alighted upon my right honourable friends, which has been denied their distinguished forebears? How come my right honourable friends think they know better than the established church? For the Chancellor, Home Secretary and Foreign Secretary today to pray and aid the argument that marriage has evolved over time is simply disingenuous. As the Honourable Member for Heywood and Middleton pointed out, nothing like this has been proposed in Parliament ever before. This is a massive change. And this legislation deeply affects the core fabric of our society through the challenge it poses to the whole institution of marriage. Reference has been made to Spain, which introduced similar legislation in 2005, and where the overall marriage rate has fallen by 20%. And since all research shows that children raised in married households with a mother and father tend to fare better than those who are not, the government threatens to damage the life chances of the nation's children. Secondly, as my right honourable friend of Chesham and Amersham pointed out, and others have done as well, neither the Prime Minister nor any other party leader has a mandate, since it was not in any party's manifesto, let alone in the coalition agreement. My right honourable friend, the Prime Minister, has insisted on sticking to the 0.7% target for overseas aid on the grounds that he gave a commitment in 2009, and I respect him for that. He has stuck to that commitment, but not to the commitment to introduce tax breaks for married couples, and he has now invented a policy which he specifically ruled out at the last general election.
Well, why don't we forgive way?
I give way to my honourable
friend. I'm grateful to my honourable friend. Does my honourable friend think that the least that should be done is that we should have had a draft bill with pre-legislative scrutiny?
Absolutely, and I think that this goes to the heart of the point that as Conservatives we're traditionally cautious about constitutional change, but not this administration. Sweeping Lords reform, major change in the law of succession, and now this bill, all to be rushed through on a timetable motion subject to a three-line whip. This is no way to treat Parliament or colleagues who have strong convictions either way on what is a very sensitive and important issue to all of us and our constituents. Thirdly, if there is no mandate, where is the demand for this change? A poll in yesterday's Daily Mail, okay, it's the Daily Mail, but it's the Daily Mail, found out that only 1 in 14, that is 7% of those questioned, thought this should be a priority. Another poll found that over 60% of the black and minority ethnic communities, the very people this party is apparently out to woo, are hostile. And fourthly, I give way to my honourable and gallant friend.
I thank my honourable friend. The majority of the population apparently don't care very much about what we're talking about today. But those people that do care, in my constituency of Beckenham, have written to me in huge numbers saying, please oppose it, far greater than those people who will be rejoicing if it's passed. Would you agree with me on that?
I do agree with my honourable and gallant friend that overwhelmingly the letters and emails I've received from my constituents are asking me to oppose this legislation. The fact is the public does not understand the full ramifications of what will flow from this legislation if it is passed. Fourthly, there is already provision for civil partnerships which provides most of the benefits of marriage to those in the gay community. Those of us who had reservations at the time were reassured that the introduction of civil partnerships should not be seen as the forerunner of today's bill. Indeed, the noble Lord, Lord Filkin, said in another place in 2004, I want to put our position very clearly. This is a new legal status that gives rights and responsibilities to people in same-sex committed relationships. We do not see it as analogous to marriage. We do not see it as a drift towards gay marriage. Clearly, those behind today's proposal feel no sense of obligation arising from those clear assurances given 10 years ago. And how can we be sure that this is now going to be the end of this process or whether there will be more? And fifthly, as my honourable friend has alluded to, what about the consequences? Take education. The department states grandly that, I quote, no teacher will be required to promote or endorse views which go against their beliefs. Yet my right honourable friend, the Secretary of State for Culture, Media and Sport, who is doing a very gallant job in very difficult circumstances, she said on the Today programme on the 25th of January that there will be no requirement on teachers to promote same-sex marriage, but she added ominously, obviously we wouldn't expect teachers to be offensive or discriminate in any way about anything. So what kind of guidance does that give the teachers in our country who have a profound objection to proclaiming other than traditional marriage? And John Bowers, the QC who defeated the government over pensioner rights, has pointed out there is no protection. Mr Deputy Speaker, I am not a Tory moderniser for... For I believe marriage can only be between a man and a woman. And I shall not surrender my principles. I believe this bill is wrong. The consultation process was a complete sham. It is opposed by the established church. It has caused deep and needless divisions within the Conservative Party. There is no mandate for it. There are huge potential consequences, not least a prospect of endless legal challenge, and the nation faces much more serious challenges which the government needs to address. I therefore hope and pray that this measure will be rejected, if not in this place, in the other place. Yeah.